Hi everyone, and a very warm welcome. If you look at the Lancet study published in 2018, India ranks 145th among the 195 countries as far as the accessibility of healthcare is concerned. When the news of COVID-19 first broke out, we were all concerned about our preparedness to take care of the rising number of cases in India. And we have seen that different cities have been grappling with the situation as and when the number of cases in their respective geographies have increased. The silver lining in this, however, has been the fact that India has emerged as a pharmacy of the world, and it has also been rightly reflected as far as the performance of healthcare is concerned. It has posted a stellar 80% returns ever since March lows. To understand the nitty-gritties of this sector, challenges, and the way forward, I am joined in by a subject matter expert, Mr. Tanmay Desai. Many thanks, Tanmay, for joining in and taking out time for us for doing this call. For the benefit of our investors, Tanmay is the fund manager at SBI Healthcare Fund. He has been associated with SBI Mutual Fund since 2008. He's a CFA charter holder from the CFA Institute, US, and has done his master's in finance from Narasimha Mundu Institute of Management Studies. Welcome, Tanmay. Let me begin by asking you that, you know, if you look at the landscape of pharma, it is very wide. You have companies taking care of biosimilars, generic drugs, formulation-based strategies, so on and so forth. So for the benefit of our investors, to start off with, can you give us some examples in the Indian context for better understanding?
Sure. Yeah. So good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for giving this opportunity to express ourselves on the subject of pharmaceuticals. By and large, when we look at India pharmaceuticals, it is a generic industry with presence across many geographies, India and US being the key of them. While when we say generics, essentially we are looking at companies which look to enter into a molecule as and when the patent expires by reverse engineering the molecule and then making a application for that product and eventually launching that particular product. The nature of the generic industry is also pretty different across various markets. While India is a branded generic market, meaning there is a field force to promote the products and 80 to 85% of the payment is done by consumers out of pocket. However, on the other hand, US is a pure generic market as the drugs are of the same quality. The doctors write the name of the molecule and not the name of the brand. And at the end of the day, it is the distributor, the insurance guys, and the pharmacy benefit manager who are the important decision makers with respect to procurement and distribution of the medicines in the US. Likewise, like the US, Europe, UK, as well as Australia are large generic markets, but emerging countries like Russia, Brazil, Mexico, South Africa, to just name a few, have a branded flavor just like India. Most pharmaceutical companies, the likes of Sun Pharma, Dr. Reddy's, Lupin, they do have a judicious mix of India, US, and some of the other markets across the globe, which could be either regulated or semi-regulated in nature. Speaking about the other domains that you were referring to start with on the biosimilars. So biosimilars essentially are products which are similar to the innovator's biotech product, just akin to what a generic product is to a chemical molecule. But they necessarily are not the same product like a generic of a chemical product. The approval pathway isn't as straightforward, and across various markets, they are deemed differently with respect to interchangeability. Biocon is one successful example of a biosimilars company. At the same time, Lupin and Dr. Reddy's have ongoing biosimilar programs, and the likes of Aurobindo are entering into this domain. An interesting subject, which is of course the talk of today, is the API business, that is active pharmaceutical ingredients, which is the input to making the formulations. Almost all companies, depending upon their strengths, they do make API for captive consumption as well as for external sales. The decision is a function of the end market product as well as requirements. It is also a well-known fact that API and key starting materials, the dependency of the world, including that of India on China, is materially high. As mentioned, while all companies do make API, there are dedicated companies with 100% of their business coming from this segment, the likes of DVs and Solara, just to name a couple of them. Lastly, with respect to contract manufacturing, CRAMS, it refers to both contract research as well as manufacturing, and it is primarily with respect to the outsourcing industry, where innovators and the generic companies are outsourcing research, product development, and manufacturing to companies who specialize in these domains. CRAMS can refer to contract research, product development, as well as contract manufacturing of API as well as formulations. And in a way, API can be termed as a loose subset of CRAMS. Examples again of companies in this space are DVs in the contract manufacturing space, and Syngene, which is into custom research and development and is also now foraying into contract manufacturing. Now that's with respect to the various sub-segments which are there on the pharmaceutical side. I'll just take a few minutes to explain the outlook that as we see in each of these segments. Starting with India, India is roughly 30% of the pharmaceutical business for Indian companies, which has been growing in double digits over the last decade, with contribution coming from volume growth, new product launches, as well as pricing. With the changes in the lifestyles in India, with low penetration, as well as an increase in awareness, the growth is also expected to be good in India in the ensuing decade. And we expect from industry experts and reports, this growth to be at around 9 to 10%, with the chronic focused companies or the brand leaders expected to grow faster than this. In the near term, growth in India is actually expected to be impacted because of regional lockdowns and as people focus more on personal hygiene. But there are new trends which are emerging, like the digital initiatives to connect to people better and teleconsultations, thereby being as close to the patient as possible, which in fact are great successes in the Western world. And only time will say how successful they turn out in India, but the initial signs definitely are quite promising. Coming to the next important market is US, which forms around 40% of business for the India pharma companies. And today in the US, India commands around 45% share by volume and around 25 to 30% share by value. Clearly, as the number suggests, our share in US is significantly high. And this is a market which is growing only at around 2 to 3% simply because of the higher spends, the higher consumption, which is already visible in US. But Indian companies, with their strength in chemistry, as well as the fact that 40% of the incremental product filings in the US are by Indian companies, India is expected to grow at probably mid to high single digits in the US. Also, while the share in the plain vanilla products, which is as what we say, tablets and capsules, is pretty high in the US, some of the large pharma companies are also now entering into specialized domains or complex manufacturing domains like injectables. We have examples of Sun Pharma, Dr. Reddy, and Aurobindo in it, and inhalers like the companies Cipla and Lupin, which are entering into this. While the outcome of these domains can be far more riskier, because of the complexity that is involved in the manufacturing as well as in the approval process, the rewards can also be quite non-linear, thereby providing enough merit for companies to enter into these domains depending upon their strengths. In terms of the rest of the world markets, I would like to divide this into two buckets. One are the generic markets, which is UK, Australia, and the likes. As Indian companies are mirroring their portfolio of US in these companies efficiently, the growth expectation in these markets is expected to be in double digits, also taking into consideration the low base that we have in these markets. The branded markets like Brazil, Russia, South Africa, which we mentioned earlier, always have had a good growth profile in double digits. Even some of the Southeast Asian countries like Philippines, which are branded markets in nature, the growth prospects are good. And Indian companies selectively have been present in some of these geographies, like, say, a Dr. Reddy, which is present in Russia, or a Torrent Pharma, which is present in Brazil, and similarly, some other companies present across the globe. On the API side, again, it being a very hot topic, the dependency on China historically has been very high. But with the pollution clampdown, which happened in China a few years back, and now with COVID-19, especially, a lot of countries and customers, including from India, want to reduce their dependency on China. And this could well be a structural growth story going forward. Simply because, A, we already have investments in the space historically. The cost competitiveness with respect to China is far better today than what historically it was. Exports peg the cost differential only to the tune of around 10 to 30% today. And third, because also we are doing a lot of formulation business in the geographies, whereby we will have a natural advantage to allow API also to be sold. While it is very early to say with 100% surety whether this will be a structural story, the near-term trends on the API front are pretty promising and the growth is much higher than historical trends. Lastly, on contract manufacturing, this has been a plausible story for quite some time, both seen even in the past. And the simple reason for this is customers are looking to outsource more as they focus more on their core competencies of research and marketing. They want to curtail cost and be associated with more focused contract manufacturing companies, many emanating from, say, India. In short, the growth is expected to be good even in the contract manufacturing space as well as on contract research space in the future, with the industry growth to be in high single digits.
Thanks, Anmay, for a very detailed, explanation on various, subsets of the pharma sector, which brings me to my next question, which is that, like any other sector, I am sure that global pharma companies would also look at cost reduction as a strategy going forward. So in the light of this, is it fair to assume that the contract research and manufacturing space has a better hold to kind of benefit from where it stands today?
Absolutely. There definitely is a lot of scope of increasing business in contract research, manufacturing, as well as product development. Let me try and explain this with a small example. Over the years, a lot of manufacturing, and as I mentioned even earlier, API is a loose subset of contract manufacturing. There was a lot of manufacturing which was in US, but as it became less and less competitive, a lot of entities out there truncated their operations or shut shop. A natural beneficiary of this has been China, India, and interestingly also Italy has emerged as a hub of API and intermediates, especially on fermentation-based products. With further expectation of the reduction of dependency on China, and with China having almost 40% of the share of the globe of API intermediates as well as basic chemicals, India naturally can be a big beneficiary of the shift, even if a small fraction of that business comes to India. If one has to go by recent trends, growth in API contract manufacturing has only gathered steam, and we are seeing a lot of investments now happening in the space. The recent announcements by the government with respect to the API parks, the hubs, the PLI schemes is definitely a step in this direction again. DVs is again a classic example of significantly enhancing their investments on the space and growing in double digits for years now. Our superior skills on chemistry, And our relatively cheap labor definitely works to our advantage to scout for more business on API as well as contract manufacturing. While the success on contract research, which is more a people-driven business, has been limited till date, the prospects are quite similar and definitely are in place for an expansion of business on the contract research side. Again, case in point being Syngene, which has been growing well over the years. Same is true with respect to contract manufacturing, also on the formulations front, wherein a few players have emerged also in this area.
Right, Tanmay. So, you know, my next question to you is that if you look at the spend in terms of GDP towards healthcare, we are at less than 2%, which is probably, you know, one of the lowest in terms of the most prominent economies in the world. Now, if I were to ask you that, I'm sure in your capacity, you would be interacting with the top management in a lot of pharma companies. So what are the kind of challenges that they actually face? What are they asked from the government? And do you think, are we prepared in terms of offering them the solutions that they need?
Correct. Before I try and answer that question, let me just give you some statistics in terms of the dire need of investment in the healthcare and the infrastructure space. While government spending on healthcare stands at just 1.3% of GDP, it is only 25% of the total spend, and private sector is spending almost 70%, taking the spend on healthcare and infrastructure to be closer to around 4-4.5% of the GDP. This is quite low in comparison to the global average of close to 9%. And countries like US, Germany, and even Canada, where the spends are in excess of 10%. US, interestingly, the spend of healthcare and infrastructure as a percentage of GDP stands at 17%. From a consumer standpoint, more than 60% of the spends are coming out of pocket. If we look at the available infrastructure also in India, they are well below industry standards. India has around 0.7 per thousand doctors versus a global average of around 1.4. US stands 2.5, Germany stands at 3.8. With respect to the beds, we have again a ratio of around 0.7 per thousand beds, while the global average is close to 3, with someone like a Germany at around 8, which also speaks how well they have been able to handle the COVID-19 pandemic situation and come out of it much faster in general. Basically, I'm trying to highlight that the statistics are clearly stacked in favor of increasing the spends and incentives towards healthcare and infrastructure. While the private investments have been increasing at a much faster pace, they still have enough room to go forward. I believe there are two relevant issues that we need to keep in mind, which can possibly benefit or allow more private investments in the space. One, with such low per capita income in India, in spite of the low cost of treatment in India, relatively, it is still not affordable to many in the country. With a health insurance penetration of only about 20%, India has one of the world's highest rate of out-of-pocket spends in healthcare. While the programs such as Ayushman Bharat are the right steps, thereby offering services to 10 crore families or 50 crore people, a lot of scope is there for enhancing such programs for the health and well-being of the country. The other important issue that I would like to highlight is hospitals in general is an asset-heavy business with a payback of maybe close to even 5 years. Break-even only happens in the third year. And hence, it is very important to incentivize the hospital business rather than creating roadblocks, which have happened in the past in terms of price caps on stents, knee replacement programs, and some such other regulations. A case in point is, you know, how our healthcare has done in the NCR region, which, you know, in which there is a dedicated land block, which has been given for every sector for both a hospital setup as well as an educational institution. While there are expectations in terms of some beds being kept aside for the schemes, such incentives still are far better in terms of it being remunerative for the overall hospital business or the healthcare business.
Right, and I think you very clearly state, and the stats reflect with themselves that we have a long way to go. And though you briefly touched upon the regulatory requirements coming in, my next question, wherein I would want a little more detailed answer from your end, is that as early as last week, we saw the General Insurance Council presenting to the Supreme Court that there should be a capping in terms of COVID-19 claims. Whereas hospitals, as you rightly said, are asset-heavy businesses, and they are not able to kind of maintain their costs and remunerations to their doctors in the given scheme of things. You also mentioned about capping in terms of 10 knee replacements, etc. So do you think that it is time that we have a dedicated regulator who kind of comes in and says that, look, this is the way to go forward, to at least maintain transparency and ensure fair treatment to all the counterparties involved?
Sure. So when we look at pharmaceuticals, the return profile of companies is exceptionally good. When we look at diagnostics, it is even more superior, it being an asset-light model. Compare it that to hospitals, in spite of very good growth prospects, but with limited available infrastructure, the return profile of hospital business is extremely inferior. As I mentioned, the payback is maybe 4 to 5 years, and the break-even is achieved, say, only in the third year. And in the intermittent regulations, like the ones we are mentioning, only is making life difficult for the hospital sector. If I look at just the first quarter, again, to just throw some numbers, with the COVID-19 pandemic situation, the operations for hospital business fell by around 70 to 80% in the months of April and May, and companies actually reported losses. Now, this bounced back to around 50-55% of pre-COVID levels in June, which is also not sufficient enough, and companies are just breaking even at this point in time. What I'm trying to highlight is that it's a very difficult business to be in. And while the long-term prospects are good, the profitability and the returns are not commensurate. And the hiccups like the price caps on some services or products, medical devices, are making things only worse. I think a dedicated regulator with clearly laid out policies would definitely help matters out here, and will call for the right type of long-term investments that the sector would need to grow more assuredly.
Thank you, Tanmay, for a very, very detailed response. And we have a few clients of ours who would be listening to this podcast and who are doctors, and they have been complaining for the rightful reasons that the response from the government with respect to their hospitals has been not very, very encouraging. Now, my next question is about exports. And, we all have been trying to increase the export in this country. And pharmaceutical is one of the few places where we are exporters to even developed countries like US. So India is the biggest exporter of generics, and US has a big share in that, like you mentioned in one of your previous questions. Now, we have had situations in last couple of years where China changed its regulation, and we could take some advantage of that, but not a huge advantage of that. And now COVID is offering us another opportunity in terms of moving business away from China to India in certain aspects. You have mentioned that we have seen some early revival and early response in that particular category. But overall, do you think that the assumption which we have about we taking share from China and we enhancing the capability of Indian pharmaceutical going forward is a strong assumption, or do you feel that there are a lot of threats to that assumption?
Correct. It's a very valid, very pertinent question. Let me try and answer this into two buckets, both with respect to formulations, business outlook, as well as on the API front. But just before that, let me, for the benefit of the listeners, also highlight the issue which is benefiting and an important monitorable with respect to China. So a few years back, with the clampdown on pollution which happened in China, a lot of facilities, both on the chemical business front as well as pharmaceutical business front, closed down citing environmental concerns, and they had to make massive investments to up their ante on the environmental regulations. The larger companies, they did reinvest, they improved upon the quality, and they could bounce back, but the smaller companies have been struggling, as we speak, are struggling to be more cost competitive, and hence not all of them are still back in the business. This, of course, made people realize a lot about the broader dependency that one has on API intermediates, which again is an input to the end product, which is formulations. The current COVID-19 situation has only made matters worse, and it has made even people even realize the dependency on China and hence the urge to kind of de-risk. Again, just to kind of give some numbers out here, 60 to 70% of the API and intermediates, they do come from China, and almost around 10 to 30% of the formulation input again is API. So one cannot do without this kind of dependency. Of the $3.5 billion worth of our imports of API and intermediates, more than 2/3 of that does come from China. And hence it is very important for us to wake up to the problem, which is the heavy dependency on China, and to be more self-sufficient. Now, let me answer your question in particular, both on the formulations front, which we believe has been less impacted and will continue to be so, and on the API front, where there are some, green shoots, but definitely something which needs to be more keenly monitored. So on the formulation side, a large part of the product filings for Indian companies are in place, and Indian companies also do have the advantage versus, say, a China with respect to the language. And this is an advantage which in our assessment is expected to kind of sustain. China has actually never been very big on the formulations front. Outside of India, US is the most important market for Indian pharmaceutical companies, and we believe this will continue to be so even in the future. Well, a good part of API and intermediates, our dependency on China is high. For regulated markets, to have better control both on supply as well as on pricing, Indian companies have been investing on backward integration of API and intermediates. And to that extent, for a number of the important export markets, we are more self-reliant, I would say. Hence, on the formulation front, we do not see the changes on the policy front on China impacting our business. And formulations is almost 80% of the total business for Indian companies. API may not be more than 20% as we speak. But of course, there lies definitely the opportunity. So as we were mentioning that the dependency on China for API and intermediates is very high, and Indian companies have gradually been investing, realizing the dependency cannot sustain at the levels at which it is. The near-term prospects definitely do look good. The pricing on API is good, again, for the reasons I mentioned, that some of the plants in China were shut, so there was a supply glut. And companies have also highlighted a very strong order book position as customers are looking to de-risk from China. Another advantage that we have been having versus China is on the quality front, where our quality has been better. And in general, the complaints are, less. In spite of all these advantages, I would say it is still too early to say how the situation is going to pan out, as the investment in India needs to materially increase to the tune of around 5 times or 10 times to be more cost competitive versus, say, a China. China clearly has the advantage of scale, and a quantum leap in terms of the scale of investment is required to be made. So we believe that this transition is going to be a bit more gradual. It is not going to be immediate. The government has announced the schemes on the API front with respect to the PLI schemes, but these are more for small ticket opportunities, and still there are certain gray areas with respect to whether these schemes are for greenfield investments only and whether they are for domestic consumption. I think there needs to be far more liberal such policies for us to increase our investments to the tune of at least 4 to 5 times the current level of investments to be cost competitive and remove the over dependency that India has on China, because the globe is clearly ready to procure more and more from India purely because we have been doing business with them and our quality stakes better than China.
Very well articulated, Tanmay, because this is not only relevant to pharmaceutical, I think it is relevant to a lot of other sector also, where we have to progress gradually. We need policies to support it, and there needs to be a financial incentive for the entities involved to pursue that path. So my next question is on medical tourism. So this is a big irony that on one hand, we always keep on saying that we have scarcity of beds, we have scarcity of hospitals. But on the other hand, we see India also as a good destination for medical tourism, where a lot of entities, a lot of people, patients from different countries come to India for treatment. Now, do you think with COVID, this situation would change, or it is an opportunity for us? Because on one hand, you would have countries which would be spending on their own health infrastructure going forward, because there is a dire need for that. And patients might have the availability of good quality hospital at their own end itself. But on the other hand, India also would have that advantage of, you know, spending extra on health infrastructure. And we definitely have an advantage of A, cost, and B, high quality doctors. So how do you think this medical tourism thing will pan out once we have normalcy and once we are out of this COVID phase?
Right. So medical tourism is around 10 to 12% of business for most of the hospital companies. As we speak, this business is practically zero. But as you rightly also highlighted that, you know, this is a good business on account of lower cost, good talent, as well as exceptionally good services. Medical tourism also stands good because a lot of expats from Middle East, from Africa, they look to come to India, which in a way is their home country. They feel close to their homes. They can be close to the relatives. They get good treatment. And medical tourism, the pricing is also good from a hospital standpoint, where it is 20 to 30% higher. So while it is anybody's guess, with respect to COVID, I think whenever COVID does normalize, our assessment is that medical tourism will again come back, but the need of the country is again more with respect to limited resources and hence to cater to a local patient more. To that extent, we believe that in the first place, medical tourism could go back to 10-15%. It is anybody's guess when that will happen, because it depends a lot on the travel restrictions which we have as on today. Some of the neighboring countries, especially Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, the business can, of course, pick up in the first place. But from all our interactions, our assessment is that medical tourism will go back to 10-15% of business. It will increase at a much faster clip going forward. But having said that, the percentage increase as a percentage of the total business for hospital companies is not going to substantially increase, simply because the need for a local patient in general is also equally high. And to that extent, they need to be also equally catered to.
Thank you, Tanmay. That answers pretty much your entire bit of that question. So coming to the next question, which is not only related to COVID, but COVID has definitely helped, is about a trend change. So we are seeing India's per capita GDP improving over a period of time, or per capita income improving. And we have had a lot of studies which indicate that as and when per capita income improves, along with discretionary spending, a lot of sensitization about health also picks up. So the probability of someone going for more diagnostic tests, probability of someone going for health insurance, which is at 20%, like you mentioned, and the possibility of somebody going and visiting hospitals more for OPDs increase. So is it a fair assumption for us to assume that with per capita income improving and with COVID acting as a catalyst, the future of health insurance companies, the future of pharmaceutical companies, and the future of hospitals, though they are asset heavy, like you mentioned, and even diagnostic companies in India, looks very much bright and looks very promising in the long run?
Definitely. So interestingly, the growth in hospitals, diagnostics, and insurance has been much more higher than in pharmaceuticals. Pharmaceuticals has been a more mature sector in general, which is why over the last decade, as you see, pharma companies have explored the export markets to grow at a clip faster than the 9-10% that we see in India. So with increased affordability, with higher insurance penetration, and again with better awareness among individuals, the growth in these areas is expected to be quite robust. To throw some examples, in the diagnostic industry, the growth is in double digits, while the organized players are growing at almost around 14 to 15%. The next 2 years, it could be even more sweeter. I should not say sweeter, but at the end of the day, when we look at COVID-19 also contributing to this business, the growth can be even faster than the 14-15%, which historically some of the leaders have enjoyed in the space. It is a very nascent industry, and as people are becoming more and more self-aware, they are going for more and more preventive care measures. To that extent, definitely the scope of growth in diagnostic business is going to remain for quite some time. Hospitals too are growing at healthy double digits, but the problem with hospitals, as we discussed, is the asset heavy nature of the business and the long gestation period of remaining invested before one starts making lucrative returns in the space. I think from a growth perspective, I do not see much threat on the three areas apart from pharmaceuticals, which is diagnostics, hospitals, as well as on the insurance side with respect to what kind of growth they can achieve. But two things which can derail some part of the story and one needs to be aware of are, one is the regulation around pricing, which can definitely be a deterrent to the long-term structural growth, both in hospitals and diagnostics. Time and again, while in hospitals we have seen the price caps coming on knee replacement and stents, time and again we have heard about pricing caps on the diagnostic businesses. And even if we take COVID as an example, there has been price revision on the diagnostic testing of COVID-19 twice or thrice, you know, now. So we have seen that impact, you know, pharmaceuticals also. Partially, we have seen that impact in pharmaceutical, in spite of medicine cost in India being materially low than in lot many other countries. The other risk that we also see is as people focus more on hygiene, like in COVID-19, people are working from home, they are focusing more and more on, you know, self-care. I think the occurrence of acute illnesses has reduced, and it is important to understand whether this is going to be a long-term trend, because this not only will impact the growth in the pharmaceutical on the acute side, but there could be less visitations to hospitals as well as less testing on the diagnostics front. I think the industry needs out-of-box thinking, like the digital initiatives we have seen and the digital consultations, which again are increasing. Companies like Apollo Hospitals are doing far lot more number of digital consultations today. They have invested a lot on the digital initiatives, thereby trying to have a full circle in terms of how they can connect to the patient. And such initiatives are important to connect and be closer to the patient in the future.
Thanks, Anmay, for a detailed response on that. My last question, and this is about stock market behavior. And this is a question generally which we ask to multi-cap fund managers, but you know, it's pertinent to ask a thematic fund manager at this point of time or a sectoral fund manager, active versus passive. So in pharmaceutical, we have seen some kind of a polarized movement over last couple of years. So you had stocks like Sun Pharmaceutical or Lupin, which were a bit drag on the index. And then you had DV's Lab, which was alpha generator for the index. So do you think in the long run, pharma is a story of stock selection, or it can be played by an index also?
It's a very tricky question, to be very honest. While inherently as a pharmaceutical analyst, my answer to that would be it's a lot to do with stock picking. But the last two or three cycles, be 2010 to 2015, where we saw, you know, a very strong pharma rally, and it was assumed to be the golden sector where nothing can damage the prospects of that. 2015 to 2019 made a lot of investors as well as pharma analysts quite humble in nature. And currently we are seeing again an up move, which is unprecedented. As you rightly you know, mentioned, almost like an 80% return that we have seen year to date. Heart and heart, there is still a belief that pharma is a bottom-up sector, because irrespective of whatever might be the environment, there are going to be enough stocks to still pick in the sector. There are still enough themes, like there is biosimilars, API, contract manufacturing, or an investment opportunity into an innovation company or a generic company, which makes it more, you know, a kind of a bottom-up sector, so to speak. So at this juncture, with problems in the broader economy and with pharma being classified as, you know, essential, as well as due to the export markets looking up, aided by the tailwinds in the currency, we do not envisage polarization in the near term. In the long run, again, there are certain sub-segments like exports, ex the US, which is now looking very, you know, promising, as well as on the API side. These are some sectors which need to be monitored more closely to understand in which direction the trajectory for the sector is expected to move. India clearly is a sector which is always going to give more promising returns. But of course, the returns can be lower considering the growth, and hence the greed of companies to scout for markets outside India at the same time. And lastly, on US, if we talk about, as I was mentioning, the share of our business in US no longer is small. And to that extent, in the future, our ability to grow in the US can definitely be kind of curtailed. With promise of growth and better profitability across segments highlighted earlier, we do not expect the euphoria in pharma to actually die down, at least in the near term. COVID-19 has just given it more prominence, and the earnings growth in the sector, which is what we believe is an important barometer, be it because of better prospects for exports, be it currency, or be it the tailwind of the COVID-19 related drug supplies or APIs, the prospects are expected to continue to be good for the sector, at least for the next 12 to 18 months. So we, to kind of summarize your question, it's still more bottom up. We do not see a polarization, and we do see the earnings growth to be strong for the sector for the next 12 to 18 months.
Thank you, Tanmay, for such a candid response. And with this, we come to the end of our discussion. But this discussion was a lot more enlightening than what we thought in a lot of ways. And for a few reasons why we feel fascinated by this sector and why we thought our investors should be educated about this sector, because this sector offers everything that India lacks in a macro way, be it about having exports, be it about having leadership position in countries like US, be it about tourism, where even we have been struggling in a large extent. And this is one of the few sectors where a fund manager is very bullish on the earning growth, which we are not expecting and seeing in anywhere else. And I would end the discussion with one of the statements from you, which is very heartening and which is very positive, that occurrence of illnesses has reduced in this COVID era. And we hope that it is not because of patient not being able to visit hospitals, but it is because patients not being there at all. So with this, we end our discussion. And thank you very much, Tanmay, for a very, very detailed and very enlightening discussion today. And really appreciate the time taken by you today. And we really hope that all of us on this discussion really don't need to visit hospital, or really don't need to have this healthcare sector. Should be in a part of our portfolio, but it should not be a part of our life. So with this, we end this discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you.